This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The Earth Trembled by E. P. Roe. Chapter 1, Mary Wallingford. At the beginning of the Civil War, there was a fine old residence on Meeting Street in Charleston, South Carolina, inhabited by a family almost as old as the state. Its inheritor and owner, Orval Burgoyne, was a widower. He had been much saddened in temperament since the death of the wife, and had withdrawn as far as possible from public affairs. His library and the past had secured a stronger hold upon his interest and his thoughts than anything in the present, with one exception, his idolized and only child, Mary, named for her deceased mother. Any book would be laid aside when she entered, all gloom banished from his eyes when she coaxed and caressed him. She was in truth one to be loved, because so capable of love herself. She conquered and ruled everyone not through willfulness or imperiousness, but by a gentle charm all her own, which disarmed opposition. At first Mr. Burgoyne had paid little heed to the mutterings which preceded the Civil War, believing them to be but Chinese thunder, produced by ambitious politicians, North and South. He was preoccupied by the study of an old system of philosophy which he fancied possessed more truth than many a more plausible and modern one. Mary, with some fancy work in her hands, often watched his deep abstraction in wondering awe, and occasionally questioned him in regard to his thoughts and studies, but as his explanations were almost unintelligible, she settled down to the complacent belief that her father was one of the most learned men in the world. At last, swiftly culminating events aroused Mr. Burgoyne from his abstraction and drove him from his retirement. He accepted what he believed to be duty, in profound sorrow and regret. His own early associations and those of his ancestors had been with the old flag and its fortunes. His relations to the political leaders of the South were too slight to produce any share in the alienation and misunderstandings which had been growing between the two great sections of his country, and he certainly had not the slightest sympathy with those who had fomented the ill will for personal ends. Finally, however, he had found himself face to face with the momentous certainty of a separation of his state from the Union. For a time he was bewildered and disturbed beyond measure, for he was not a prompt man of affairs, living keenly in the present, but one who had been suddenly and rudely summoned from the academic groves of the old philosophers to meet the burning imperative questions of the day, questions put with the passionate earnestness of a people excited beyond measure. It was this very element of popular feeling which finally turned the scale in his decision. Apparently, the entire Southern people were unanimous in their determination to be free and to separate themselves from their old political relations. His pastor, with all other friends of his own rank, confirmed this impression, and as it was known that he wavered, the best and strongest men of his acquaintance argued the question with him. His daughter was early carried away by the enthusiasm of her young companions. Nevertheless, she watched the conflict in her father's mind with the deepest interest. She often saw him walk the floor with unwonted tears in his eyes and almost agony on his brow. And when at last he decided in accordance with the prevailing sentiment of his state, the act of secession and all that it involved became sacred in her thoughts. She trembled and shrank when the phase of negotiation passed away, and war was seen to be the one alternative to submission. She never doubted or hesitated, however, neither did her father after his mind was once made up. Every day the torrent of bitter feeling deepened and broadened between them and the North, of which, practically, they knew very little. Even such knowledge as they possessed had come through distorted mediums, and now everything was colored by the blackest prejudice. They were led to believe and made to feel that not only their possessions, but their life and honor were at stake. In early years, Mr. Burgoyne had served with distinction in the war with Mexico, and he therefore promptly received a commission. The effect of her father's decision and action had been deepened a hundredfold by an event which occurred soon afterward. Among the thousands who thronged to Charleston when Fort Sumter was attacked was the son of a wealthy planter residing in the interior of the state. This young soldier's enthusiasm and devotion were much bruited in the city because, waiving wealth and rank, he had served as a private. His fearlessness at Fort Moultrie enhanced his reputation, and when the small garrison of heroes, commanded by Major Anderson, succumbed, Sidney Wallingford found that he had been voted a hero himself, especially by his fair compatriots with whom he had formerly danced when visiting the town. The young fellow's head was not easily turned, however, for when, at an evening gathering, a group was lauding the great achievement, he said disdainfully, "What thousands against 70? Despise the Yankees as we may, the odds were too great. The only thing we can plume ourselves upon is that we would have fought just the same had the 70 been 7,000. I think the fellows did splendidly if they were Yankees, yet what else could we expect, since their commander was a Southern man? Oh no, we must wait till the conditions are more even before we can exult over our victories. I reckon we'll have them all the same, though." Murmurs of approbation followed these remarks, but he saw only the eloquent eyes of Mary Burgoyne, and offering her his arm, led her away. The spring night was as warm as a June evening at the north, and they joined the groups that were strolling under the moonlight in the garden. Sidney felt the young girl's hand tremble on his arm, and he drew it closer to his side. She soon asked falteringly, "Mr. Wallingford, do you think, will the conditions become more even as you suggested? Can it be that the North will be so carried away by this abolition fanaticism as to send armies and ships in the vain effort to subjugate us?" "Thank you, Miss Mary, for saying that it will be a vain effort. Of course it will be, with such men as my father," and she suddenly hesitated. "And who else?" he gently asked, trying to look into her averted face. "Oh, well," she stammered with a forced little laugh, "thousands of brave fellows like you. You do not answer my question. Are we to have anything like a general war? Surely there ought to be enough good, wise men on both sides to settle the matter." "The matter might be settled easily enough," he replied lightly. "We know our rights, and shall firmly assert them. If the Yankees yield, all well; if not, we'll make 'em. But making them may mean a great war." "Oh yes, some serious scrimmages, I reckon. We're prepared, however, and will soon bring the North to its senses. If anything should happen to my father," she sighed. He had led her beneath the shadow of a palmetto, and now breathed into her ear, "Mary, dear Mary, how much I'd give to hear you say in the same tone, 'If anything should happen to Sidney.'" She did not withdraw her hand from his arm, and he again felt it tremble more than before. "Mary," he continued earnestly, "I have asked your father if I might speak to you, and he did not deny me the privilege. Oh, Mary, you must have seen my love in my eyes and heard it in my tones long since. Mary," he concluded impetuously, "let me but feel that I am defending you as well as my state, and I can and will be a soldier in very truth." She suddenly turned and sobbed on his shoulder, "That's what I fear. I can hide my secret from you no longer, that's what I fear. Those I love will be exposed to sudden and terrible death. I am not brave at all." "Shall I go home and plant cotton?" he asked, half jestingly. "No, no, 1,000 times no, she cried passionately. "Have I not seen the deep solemnity with which my father accepted duty so foreign to his tastes and habits? Can you think I would wish you to shrink or fail, you who are so strong and brave? No, no, in very truth. Self must mean only self-sacrifice until our sacred cause is won. Yet think twice, Sidney, before you bind yourself to me. I fear I am not so brave as other women appear to be in these times. My heart shrinks unspeakably from war and bloodshed. Although I shall not falter, I shall suffer agonies of dread. I cannot let you go to danger with stern words and dry eyes. I fear you'll find me too weak to be a soldier's wife." He led her into deeper and shadier seclusion as he asked, "Do you think I'll hesitate because you have a heart in your bosom instead of a stone? No, my darling. We must keep a brave aspect to the world, but my heart is as tender toward you as yours toward me. What else in God's universe could I dread more than harm to you? But there is little cause to fear. The whole South will soon be with us, foreign nations will recognize us as an independent people, and then we will dictate our own terms of peace. Then you shall be my bride in this, our proud city by the sea." He kissed away her tears, and they strolled through the shadowy walks until each had regained the composure essential in the bright drawing rooms. A commission with the rank of captain was speedily offered young Wallingford. He accepted it, but said he would return home and raise his own company. This action was also applauded by his friends and the authorities. Mary saw her father smile approvingly and proudly upon her choice, and he became her ideal hero as well as lover. He fulfilled his promises, and before many weeks passed, re-entered Charleston with 100 brave fellows devoted to him. The company was incorporated into one of the many regiments forming, and Mr. Burgoyne assured his daughter that the young captain was sure of promotion and would certainly make a thorough soldier. Even in those early and lurid days, a few things were growing clear, and among them was the fact that the North would not recognize the doctrine of state rights nor peaceably accept the act of secession. Soldiers would be needed. How long, no one knew, for the supreme question of the day had passed from the hands of statesmen to those of the soldier. The lack of mutual knowledge, the misapprehension, and the gross prejudices existing between the two sections would have been ludicrous had they not been fraught with such long-continued woes. Southern papers published such stuff as this: "The Northern soldiers are men who prefer enlisting to starvation, scurvy fellows from the back slums of cities, with whom Falstaff would not have marched through Coventry. Let them come south, and we will put our negroes at the dirty work of killing them. But they will not come south. Not a wretch of them will live on this side of the border longer than it will take us to reach the ground and drive them off." The Northern press responded in kind. No man of sense, it was declared, could for a moment doubt that this much ado about nothing would end in a month. The Northern people are simply invincible. The rebels, a mere band of ragamuffins, will fly like chaff before the wind on our approach. Thus the wretched farces of bluster continued on either side, until in blood, agony, and heartbreak, Americans learned to know Americans. President Lincoln, however, had called out 75,000 troops, and these men were not long in learning that they could not walk over the South in 3 months. The South also discovered that these same men could not be terrified into abandoning the attempt. There were thoughtful men on both sides who early began to recognize the magnitude of the struggle upon which they had entered. Among these was Major Burgoyne, and the presentiment grew upon him that he would not see the end of the conflict. When, therefore, impetuous young Wallingford urged that he might call Mary his wife before he marched to distant battlefields, the father yielded, feeling that it might be well for her to have another protector besides himself. The union was solemnized in Old St. Michael's Church, where Mary's mother and grandmother had been married before her. A day or two of quiet and happiness was vouchsafed, and then came the tidings of the first great battle of the war. Charleston responded with acclamations of triumph. Bells sent out their merriest peals. Cannon thundered from every fort on the harbor, but Mary wept on her husband's breast. Among the telegrams of victory had come an order for his regiment to go north immediately. Not even a brief honeymoon was permitted to her. End of the chapter. End of the chapter. Chapter 2, Love's Agony. As the exaggerated reports of a magnificent Confederate victory at Bull Run continued to pour in, Major Burgoyne shared for a time in the general elation, believing that independence, recognition abroad, and peace had been virtually secured. All the rant about Northern cowardice appeared to be confirmed, and he eagerly waited for the announcement that Washington had been captured by Johnston's victorious army. Instead, came the dismal tidings from his only sister that her husband, Captain Hunter, had been killed in the battle over which he had been rejoicing. Then, for some mysterious reason, the Southern army did not follow the Federals, who had left the field in such utter rout and panic. It soon appeared that the contending forces were occupying much the same positions as before. News of the second great uprising of the North followed closely, and presaged anything but a speedy termination of the conflict. Major Burgoyne was not a Hotspur, and he grew thoughtful and depressed in spirit, although he sedulously concealed the fact from his associates. The shadow of coming events began to fall upon him, and his daughter gradually divined his lack of hopefulness. The days were already sad and full of anxiety, for her husband was absent. He had scouted the idea of the Yankees standing up before the impetuous onset of the Southern soldiers, and his words had apparently proved true. Yet even those Northern cowards had killed one closely allied to her before they fled. Remembering, therefore, her husband's headlong courage, what assurance of his safety could she have, although victory followed victory? Major Burgoyne urged his widowed sister to leave her plantation in the charge of an overseer and make her home with him. "You are too near the probable theater of military operations to be safe," he wrote, "and my mind cannot rest till you are with us in this city which we are rapidly making impregnable." The result was that she eventually became a member of his family. Her stern, sad face added to the young wife's depression, for the stricken woman had been rendered intensely bitter by her loss. Mary was too gentle in nature to hate readily, yet wrathful gleams would be emitted at times even from her blue eyes, as her aunt inveighed in her hard monotone against the monstrous wrong of the North. They saw their side with such downright sincerity and vividness that the offenders appeared to be beyond the pale of humanity. Few men, even though the frosts of many winters had cooled their blood and ripened their judgment, could reason dispassionately in those days, much less women, whose hearts were kept on the rack of torture by the loss of dear ones or the dread of such loss. "It is my purpose to dwell upon the war, its harrowing scenes and intense animosities, only so far as may be essential to account for my characters and to explain subsequent events. The roots of personality strike deep, and the taproot, heredity, runs back into the being of those who lived and suffered before we were born." Gentle Mary Burgoyne should have been part of a happier day and generation. The bright hopes of a speedily conquered peace were dying away. The foolish bluster on both sides at the beginning of the war had ceased, and the truth so absurdly ignored at first, that Americans North and South would fight with equal courage, was made clearer by every battle. The heavy blows received by the South, however, did not change her views as to the wisdom and righteousness of her cause, and she continued to return blows at which the armies of the North reeled, stunned and bleeding. Mary was not permitted to exult very long, however, for the terrible pressure was quickly renewed with an unwavering pertinacity which created misgivings in the stoutest hearts. The Federals had made a strong lodgment on the coast of her own state, and were creeping nearer and nearer, often repulsed, yet still advancing as if impelled by the remorseless principle of fate. At last, in the afternoon of a day early in April, events occurred never to be forgotten by those who witnessed them. Admiral DuPont, with his armored ships, attempted to reduce Fort Sumter and capture the city. Thousands of spectators watched the awful conflict, Mary Wallingford and her aunt, Mrs. Hunter, among them. The combined roar of the guns exceeded all the thunder they had ever heard. About 300 Confederate cannon were concentrated on the turreted monitors, and some of the commanders said that shots struck the vessels as fast as the ticking of a watch. It would seem that the ships which appeared so diminutive in the distance must be annihilated, yet Mary with her powerful glass saw them creep nearer and nearer. It was their shots, not those of her friends, that she watched with agonized absorption, for every tremendous bolt was directed against the fort in which was her father. The conflict was too unequal. The bottom of the harbor was known to be paved with torpedoes, and in less than an hour DuPont withdrew his squadron in order to save it from destruction. In strong reaction from intense excitement, Mary's knees gave way and she sank upon them in thankfulness to God. Her aunt supported her to her room, gave restoratives, and the daughter in deep anxiety waited for tidings from her father. He did not come to her, he was brought, and there settled down upon her young life a night of grief and horror which no words can describe. While he was sighting a gun, it had been struck by a shell from the fleet, and when the smoke of the explosion cleared away he was seen among the debris, a mangled and unconscious form. He was tenderly taken up, and after the conflict ended, conveyed to his home. On the way thither he partially revived, but reason was gone. His eyes were scorched and blinded, his hearing destroyed by the concussion, and but one lingering thought survived in the wreck of his mind. In a plaintive and almost childlike tone he continually uttered the words, "I was only trying to defend my city and my home." Hour after hour he repeated this sentence, deaf to his child's entreaties for recognition and a farewell word. His voice grew more and more feeble, until he could only whisper the sad refrain. At last his lips moved, but there was no sound, then he was still. For a time it seemed as if Mary would soon follow him, but her aunt, her white face tearless and stern, bade her lie for her husband and her unborn child. These sacred motives eventually enabled her to rally, but her heart now centered its love on her husband with an intensity which made her friends tremble for her future. His visits had been few and brief, and she lived upon his letters. When they were delayed, her eyes had a hunted, agonized look which even her stoical aunt could not endure. One day about midsummer she found the stricken wife, unconscious upon the floor with the daily paper in her clenched hand. When at last the physician had brought back feeble consciousness and again banished it by the essential opiate, Mrs. Hunter read the paragraph which, like a bolt, had struck down her niece. It was from an account of a battle in which the Confederates had been worsted and were being driven from a certain vantage point. "At this critical moment," ran the report, "Colonel Wallingford, with his thinned regiment, burst through the crowd of fugitives rushing down the road and struck the pursuing enemy such a stinging blow as to check its advance. If the heroic colonel and his little band could only have been supported at this instant, the position might have been regained. As it was, they were simply overwhelmed as a slight obstacle is swept away by a torrent. But few escaped. Some were captured, while the colonel and the majority were struck down, trampled upon, and fairly obliterated as the northern horde of infantry and artillery swept forward all the more impetuously. The check was a very great advantage, however, for it gave our vastly outnumbered troops more time to rally in a stronger position." This brief paragraph contained the substance of all that was ever learned of the young husband, and his mangled remains filled an unknown grave. His wife had received the blow direct, and she never rallied. Week after week she moaned and wept upon her bed when the physician permitted consciousness. Even in the deep sleep produced by opiates, she would shudder at the sound of Gilmore's guns as they thundered against Forts Sumter and Wagner. A faithful colored woman, who had been a slave in the family from infancy, watched unweariedly beside her, giving place only to the stern-visaged aunt, whose touch and words were gentle, but who had lost the power to disguise the bitterness of her heart. She tried to awaken maternal instincts in the wife, but in vain, for there are wounds of the spirit, like those of the body, which are fatal. All efforts to induce the widow to leave the city, already within reach of the federal guns, were unavailing, and she was the more readily permitted to have her own way, because, in the physician's opinion, the attempt would prove fatal. Meanwhile, her time was drawing near. One August night she was dozing and moaning in her sleep, when suddenly there was a strange, demoniac shriek through the air, followed by an explosion which in the still night was terrifically loud. The invalid started up and looked wildly at her sable nurse, who was trembling like a leaf. "Oh, Lord have mercy, missus," she exclaimed. "Dem Yankees shellin' de town." Mrs. Hunter was instantly at the bedside. The faithful doctor came hurriedly of his own accord and employed all his skill. A few hours later, Mrs. Hunter tried to say cheerily, "Come, Mary, here is a fine little girl for you to love and live for." "Auntie," said the mother calmly, "I am dying. Let me see my child and kiss her. Then put her next my heart till it is cold." Mrs. Hunter lifted her startled eyes to the physician, who sadly nodded his head in acquiescence. In a few moments more the broken heart found healing far beyond all human passion and strife. With hot yet tearless eyes, and a face that appeared to be chiseled from marble in its whiteness and rigidity, the aunt took up the child. Her tone revealed the indescribable intensity of her feelings as she said, "Thy name is Mara Bitterness." End of the chapter. End of the chapter. Chapter 3, Uncle Sheba's Experience. Many years have elapsed since the events narrated in the last chapter occurred, and the thread of story is taken up again in the winter of 1886. In a small dwelling, scarcely more than a cabin, and facing on an obscure alley in Charleston, a rotund colored woman of uncertain age is sitting by the fire with her husband. She is a well-known character in the city, for she earns her bread by selling cakes, fruits, and other light articles which may be vended in the street with chances of profit. Although Aunt Sheba, as she was familiarly called, had received no training for mercantile pursuits, yet her native shrewdness had enabled her to hit upon the principles of success, as may be discovered by the reader as the story progresses. She had always been so emphatically the master of the house and the head of the family that her husband went by the name of Uncle Sheba. It must be admitted that the wife shared in the popular opinion of her husband. When in an amiable mood, which, happily, was her usual condition of mind, she addressed him as UNC. When some of his many shortcomings exhausted her good nature, for Aunt Sheba had more good nature than patience, he was severely characterized as Mr. Bugon. Since they had been brought up in Major Burgoyne's family, they felt entitled to his surname, and by evolution it had become Bugon. Uncle Sheba's heart failed him when his wife addressed him by this title, for he knew he was beyond the deadline of safety. They dwelt alone in the cabin, their several children, with one exception, having been scattered, they knew not where. Adjacent was another cabin, owned by a son-in-law named Kern Watson, who had married their youngest daughter years before, and he was the pride of Aunt Sheba's heart. Uncle Sheba felt that he was not appreciated, or perhaps appreciated too well, by his son-in-law, and their intercourse was rather formal. On the evening in question, supper was over, but the table had not yet been cleared. Uncle Sheba was a good deal of an epicure, and having left not a scrap of what his wife had vouchsafed to him, was now enjoying his corncob pipe. Aunt Sheba also liked a good square meal as much as anyone, and she had the additional satisfaction that she had earned it. At this hour of the day, she was usually very tired, and was accustomed to take an hour's rest before putting her living room in order for the night. Although the twilight often fell before she returned from her mercantile pursuits, she never entrusted Uncle Sheba with the task of getting supper, and no housekeeper in the city kept her provisions under lock and key more rigorously than did Aunt Sheba. After repeated trials,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.